Hey guys, so I'm going to show you how to use a couple different tools in Photoshop to build a little more consistency into how your letter forms are framed in the 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. So, what we have now are a few photos. If you're shooting consistently, things should look roughly like this. The letter form should be in about the same place in the screen. That's one of the benefits of using a stationary copy stand setup. You can place things kind of in the same spot every time, so in post you're not having to shift things around radically. However, every once in a while, something gets a little off-center, as you can see this is. So I'm going to show you how to remedy that. I will say that in order for what I'm about to show you to work, you guys have to have plenty of extra area around the actual image you're shooting. This wouldn't work if this was very tightly cropped. Basically, what we're taking advantage of is all this additional real estate to reposition things within an ultimately cropped frame. So, the first thing we need to do is figure out how far off this is from the rest of them. Now, again, you should be shooting these fairly consistently, but we recognize that not all the letters are going to be quite the same size as you're building these. Unless you're using something modular, which many of you aren't, they may end up being a little bigger or a little smaller. That's okay. What we want to do, though, is ultimately get the baseline and the cap height guide set so that you have a frame of reference. And so I'm going to show you how to do that. There's a couple different ways to add guides. One is manually, and I'll show you how to do that right now. You have to go up to View and Rulers. You can see the shortcut is Command-R, but that produces these rulers over here. Command-R, puts them on all the documents. If you're just dealing with a single letter form, you can add them manually, and you click on the ruler on whatever axis you want to add a guide to. So we're going to do the horizontal ones first. We're going to put that right about there. That looks like where the baseline is. We're going to put this at the top. That's about where the cap height is. And I should mention that all the things I'm doing here are optically aligned. That is, even though this goes over the top, it occupies so little amount of space that truly the cap height is kind of actually a little below where this little ascender goes. So I'm just eyeballing these for now. But like I said, there's also a manual way to add guides, and that is to go up to View, New Guide, and you can very precisely type in where you want the guide. So I want a horizontal guide at 13.5 inches. I want another guide at 8.25 inches, we'll say. I'm not sure if that's right, but it's pretty close. We'll let that sit. Now I want to add those same guides to this document. Photoshop, to my knowledge, is the only Adobe program that won't let you select and copy guides through to other documents. It's kind of a bummer because it's a pain in the butt to add them. You can see what happened when I did try and select them. I get a little warning dialog box. So we're going to back up a bit, get rid of those guides via the history palette, go back in time. The easiest way, I think, to do it is take advantage of actions. So you'll remember actions from the resize we did, which is still up here. We're going to do that for the guide, so we're going to click Create New Action. We're going to give it a name, Funny Face Guides. Click Record. You can see it's recording down here. We're going to go up here and add those new guides just like we did before, 13.5 inches. New guide. Oops. Don't want that. 8.25 inches. There they are. We're going to turn that off. There they are. Let's go get rid of those. We'll go back to the actions palette, and you can see just by hitting play, Just going to put them in right where we need them to. We'll do it to this one too. But you can see this is a bit of an outlier in that this isn't sitting on the baseline and this is well above the cap height, which for consistency's sake is no bueno. So we need to fix that, and that means shifting this letter form down to sit on this baseline. If I try and select this layer in Photoshop and click and drag it, again, I get the warning dialog box says I can't because it's locked. You need to unlock it. And you simply just double click on that lock. It'll convert it to from the background layer, which is inherently locked, to an unlocked new layer. Now I can click on it and drag it down until it sits comfortably on the baseline, and we're set. The thing is, though, and you'll want to deal with this, you want to do this now, or else you'll be dealing with it later, is you want to relock this layer so that now we can't move it around and accidentally shift it off that baseline. You don't necessarily have to do that, but it is good practice, and it'll make things easier when you're in the crop tool dialog box, which I will show you in a minute. However, we're still on guides, and what I want to do is add vertical guides. Now, I want to do that manually because every letter form is going to be a little bit different. Because there's more visual weight, and I am speaking about visual or optical center here, not true center as defined by measurement. But a letter form like F, you can see, has far more visual weight on the left side than it does right. So if you were to measure the distance between this outermost right point and the outermost left point and find the actual center, what you're going to have is something over in here, and it won't necessarily optically look centered. It's always going to look shifted to one direction or the other. So on all these letters, I want to add the optical center by clicking over here on the vertical ruler axes and dragging it to where I think is the center point. I'm not entirely sure that's it. It's a good reference, though. So we're going to go there. We'll say that's about right. Same with this guy. So we now have a baseline, cap height, and a center line. And we're going to now move into cropping so that they're consistent. So to do that, we're going to make use of the crop tool, which lays over here in the toolbox. It looks like an old school crop slider. And you'll notice when I hover over it, at least briefly, it'll say the shortcut. That follows for all of these tools in the toolbox. You can see if you hit a J, it'll select that spot healing brush. They generally all make sense. The eyedropper tool is I, the crop tool is C, and that's what we get when we're in the crop tool itself. So there's a bunch of options you can explore in here. I'm not going to go over them all in great detail except for the ones you need to know, the most vital ones. This controls your ratio. So you can have an original ratio that follows whatever it came out of your camera as. You can have an unconstrained freeform crop. For our purposes though, and because we're going to be printing on 8.5 by 11 letter paper, we're going to select 8.5 by 11 so that our output takes advantage of every square inch of our paper, which you all should be doing. So I now have this crop dialog box. The other thing that you can see are this rule of thirds grid. That's up here in the view. This drop down, you can do a diagonal set. You can do a grid, for instance. These are all just there to help you. I'm going to use the rule of thirds because it'll be easy, but whatever you need to set up to get the job done. The only other thing I want to mention in this particular tutorial is this specifically. So there is a checkbox to be had next to the line delete crop pixels. If you check this, once you apply a crop, whatever you cropped out of the image is lost forever. You have opportunities to go back and address that with the history palette, but that also undoes everything you've done prior to that. This, however, if you leave it unchecked, allows you to come back to it at any time. So if I, for whatever reason, decide this is a correct crop, and I apply it. If I come back at a later date after I've done something and click on the crop tool again and adjust, you can see all the pixels that were allegedly lost are in fact still there. So I would say, generally speaking, it's best to leave it unchecked. More revision possibilities are always better. You never know when you're going to need it or need to resize an original image. So I would say leave it unchecked. But it is ultimately up to you. So what I'm going to use is these rule of thirds. And I am going to resize this until the top third falls on the cap height, and the bottom third falls on the baseline. We're going to get pretty close, and there we are. You can also notice there's a center point, and I'm going to use that to shift things one way or the other. You can use your arrow keys to shift things, but it can be pretty tedious. As a tip, if you hold down the shift key, it'll move your palette 10 actual individual clicks at a time. You can see it jumps quite a bit more. So I'm going to center that up and click OK. Now you can see that actually it's a little off. The center line I placed in isn't quite optical center. So we're going to go back, and that's where it's nice to have access to all these pixels that you didn't delete, and adjust. That's getting a little closer. Maybe that's a little too far, but I'm going to stop futzing with it for now. I'm going to click OK, and we're going to clear the guides. If you hold down Command semicolon, it'll shift those on and off. You can also access that through the View dropdown at the top. But that looks pretty decent. We're going to do the same thing. Crop. I'm going to shift it quite a bit. Move it onto pretty good. So now you can see, well, perhaps we need to shift it over a little more. But now you can see that whereas this was once off-center, it's now very consistent between the two. And that's the most important thing, that they're sharing a baseline, that they're sharing a cap height, and that the margins are all equal, or as close to equal as possible, more on the top and bottom than the side bearings of the left and right. Because you have to remember that if this was an eye, for instance, there'd be a lot more of a margin on the left and right side. But you guys get the gist. You can repeat it for this, of course. I won't, because you already get it, and this video is running long, and I'm sure you got better things to do. Hopefully this helps. Let me know if you have any questions, and I'll see you in class.